key feature of 5G is the support of non-terrestrial networks, or NTNs. Now, when you're describing NTNs, you typically start talking about satellite-based communications, and these satellites can be at various orbits. And for this course, we're going to focus on that form of NTN, satellite-based 5G, effectively. However, NTNs broadly cover UAVs, unmanned aerial vehicles. Again, these can be at various heights. But in addition, NTNs also cover cells being generated from, for example, aircraft. So the idea is we've got different permutations under this wide umbrella of NTN. Now, when we start talking about the use of NTN, why do we need it? The main reason is coverage. So the idea is terrestrial networks can go so far, but in certain scenarios, different use cases, it's impractical to potentially have a terrestrial deployment, and therefore a non-terrestrial deployment is more advantageous. And we're going to have a look at some of those use cases. So that's one area. Another area would be to provide additional capacity in certain geographical locations for certain types of service. Again, it depends on the use case. And then finally, with the support of NTN networks, you get additional capabilities. So again, this depends on the system and different use cases, but again, we're going to cover off some of these additional capabilities and use cases with respect to satellite-based communications. Now, those key improvements facilitate some new use cases. Now, we're going to be looking at use cases in more detail later on in the course, but for now, at a high level, we've got some groupings here of some high-level use cases. So to start with, I've got my mobility-based devices. So whether it's a vehicle, a handheld device, some form of truck or an airplane, the idea is we could use 5G NTN networks to provide extra connectivity to these devices where potentially terrestrial networks can't. We could use it for backhaul. So backhaul is a very loose term, but the idea is we already use satellite backhaul anyway, but obviously having that ability to have 5G satellite backhaul potentially will give that extra boost of capabilities eventually. And you'll see why I mean the word eventually a little bit later on in the course, because currently the deployments of 5G NTN networks isn't going to tick all the boxes for high capacity. But this backhaul could be from an existing, say, 5G cell site, and backhauling from that, or we could be backhauling from another cell site technology or another technology, for example, Wi-Fi. So we have a Wi-Fi hotspot and we're using satellite to backhaul from that location. Now, similar to backhaul, we can use the term trunking or head end. And this is more of an aggregation of lots of endpoints going through a central location. So in this particular example, you might have a lot of connectivity in a potentially, say, a village, all sort of physically connected here. And the idea is they're all going through this aggregation point, this head end, and utilizing that as a mechanism to get that information back through the satellite system to where it needs to be. When we start hearing the word satellite communications, a lot of people start linking into the services you get from satellites, for example, broadcast TV, things like that. So it's not unreasonable to say, well, 5G could provide that type of service as well. So linking into sort of multiplay services where you're getting connectivity for phone lines, for broadband data, for TV, etc., those types of services. So these are some of the high-level use cases of 5G. Focusing on the terminology with respect to non-terrestrial networks, we've got a satellite-enabled device. And again, we're going to utilize the scenario with satellite communications as an example. And this device wants to connect to some form of data network. Now, if it's a satellite-based system, we're going to need one or more satellites, again, depending on the type of deployment. Again, we're going to come back to that a little bit later. Now, that satellite effectively relays the information down to what's called an earth station or ground station. Now, from there, we need to connect to the data network. So you might find there's other, if you like, connectivity requirements with respect to that location. However, Other terminology that we need to be familiar with is the term feeder link. So the feeder link goes from the Earth station up to the satellite, and then the satellite to the actual device is referred to as the service link. So we have a feeder link and we have a service link. And when we start describing 5G operation, what we're going to be looking at is how or what part of 5G fits onto this diagram. And that's something we're going to have a look at later in a lot more detail in terms of the 5G NTN architecture. This is just the generic architecture with some key terminology. The satellite will also have a payload. So that's quite a key term, and we're going to see more about different implementations of different types of payload. So that's a lot to do with how the signal is actually either relayed or processed, and what, if you like, features and functions are taking place within the satellite for this communication service. Again, we'll have a look at some examples of that a little bit later. Now, when we start describing existing non-terrestrial network satellite-based systems, there's lots of different providers out there providing different services. So I'm not going to go specifically looking at individual solutions. I'm just going to give you a sort of an insight to, you know, what existing satellite systems offer. So they may be related to things like broadcast TV, broadcast radio. Obviously, the most common there would be things like Sky providing that level of service. We could look at navigation. So GNSS, the Global Navigation Satellite Systems, including things like GPS in there. We've got mobile communication. So again, we could add 5G into this sort of part of the discussion here, but we have existing mobile-based communication satellite systems. We can think about remote sensing and imaging. A good example there will be things like weather satellites. We've got general broadband connectivity. So there is a lot of investment currently going into broadband satellite solutions. And obviously 5G is going to just fuel that specifically. A key part of 5G offering is also linking into Internet of Things or machine-to-machine type communications via satellite. And again, it's a very big use case. And obviously 5G and 4G before it had a lot of IoT offerings. So to facilitate that via an NTN network provides many, many use cases. So again, that's quite a big part with respect to 5G. We've also got satellite systems for emergency response or disaster relief type scenarios, again, linking into communication, imagery, lots of other things as well. In addition, final one there is satellite telehealth. So again, the ability, and there's various use cases with respect to getting medical information being relayed via the satellite-based systems, again, linking into various use cases. So these are some of the key areas where existing satellite deployments already tick certain boxes, and the idea is 5G coming along is going to enrich some of these, again, depending on the use case that we're focusing on. Now, when it comes to satellite systems, we have to think standardization. And the reason being, satellites obviously orbit the Earth, and by definition, they cross lots of international boundaries. And as such, the ITU, the International Telecommunications Union, it has a key role in standardizing global satellite-based operation frequencies and deployments. So the idea is they sort of tick the sort of highest box with respect to global awareness. We then have various other organizations such as ETSI, European Telecommunications Standards Institute, which again specifically has various use cases related to the satellite-based solutions. Again, ticking lots of capabilities there. However, we're talking about 5G NTN, 5G non-terrestrial networks, and as such, we have to incorporate 3GPP, the third generation partnership project, into that discussion. Now, with respect to 5G, 5G started its life in 3GPP release 15. So 3GPP has lots of effectively versions, and with different and newer versions, we get new features. So originally, we can go right back into the early versions, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And when we get to version 15, we added 5G operation. So we added the capability of doing 5G at that point in time. However, it wasn't all about 5G non-terrestrial networks at that particular point in time. It wasn't until latter releases that we started to standardize more 5G end-to-end operation. So when it comes to these releases, release 16 started having lots of work items with respect to non-terrestrial network operation, but the majority of the detail of 5G NTN was added in release 17. So that's when we started standardizing things like the frequency operations, some of the device requirements. Now, early releases had lots of discussions going on, but they were missing some of the finer details of the actual deployment and some of the specifics. So really we needed a release 17, but it's not a case of release 7 came along and it provided all the answers. It's an ongoing, evolving process. So when you start looking at 5G NTN-based systems, you'll be looking at release 17 and going, well, actually, that's great, but what about this, this, and this? And you'll be then going into possibly release 18 to find some of those answers in there. Now, it's worth pointing out, as far as 5G is concerned, 5G evolves, and at release 18, it becomes 5G advanced. So you can see here, we've got release 18 providing that sort of correlation to 5G advanced. And this is where we are with respect to, you know, this the next stepping stone with respect to 5G NTN networks. And it's going to be release 18, release 19, where we start seeing more effectively capabilities, more adoption with respect to the 5G NTN standards.